In this video, I am going to give you a quick review of Python list. You may be already familiar with the concept of array in other languages such as Java, but in Python, the equivalent type that is most commonly used is called list. Just like an array, a list is basically a collection of elements, whatever their types might be. They could be numbers, strings, or we could even have a list of lists in Python. An array or Python list is one of the most commonly used types, so it is important to know how to use it for recording interviews. Now, to initialize a list, you can write equals item 1, item 2, and item 3 with square brackets, and this initializes a list named A with the three strings. To retrieve an element from this list, you can write a square brackets 0, which retrieves the first element. Item 1 and a square brackets 1 retrieves a second element, item 2. So Python list is 0 index, or the indices in a Python list start at 0. To change an element in this list, you can write a square brackets 1 equals new item name, and this sets the second element or the element at index 1 to be new item name. If you print the element at the index 1 with print a square brackets 1, then it will print out the new element, which is new item name. In a Python list, you could even mix types, for example, with numbers in a string. To find the length of a list, you can call the len function with the list as the input. So if there are 3 items in a list A, length of A would return 3. Now let's quickly go over 2 different ways to iterate over each element in a list in Python. Let's say we have our list A with the elements item 0, item 1, and item 2. The first way to iterate over each element in this list is this. For element in A, print element, and this would go through each item in this list and print it out. Item 0, item 1, and item 2. So that's the first method. To understand the second way to iterate over each element in a list, you first need to understand what the range function does. Range of 3 produces essentially a list with the elements 0, 1, and 2. It's not exactly a list, but it acts like it in this for loop segment. For I in range 3, print I. This would print out 0, 1, and 2 because we are just iterating over each element in this like object with the elements 0, 1, and 2. Using this, we can now iterate over each element in any list by index. Let's say we have the same list as before. We did elements item 0, item 1, and item 2. So if we do for I in range of 3, print a square bracket I would go from 0 to 1 to 2, and this block will print out them 0, item 1, and item 2. Because a square bracket 0 returns item 0, and a square bracket 1 returns item 1, and a square bracket 2 returns item 2. And instead of writing for I in range of 3, we can also replace 3 with length a, because the length of this list is 3. These two methods of list iteration are useful in different situations. For example, the for I in range syntax allows you to iterate over multiple lists at the same time using the same index. Here are some exercise problems for Python list. You can open this notebook with Jupyter Notebook. I am just going to maximize this window just so that we have a little more space here. Problem 1. Initialize a new list called a-list with the elements item 1, item 2, and item 3. For this one, I am going to write a list equals square brackets and double quotes or single quotes for a string and item 1, comma item 2, comma item 3. I am going to load this cell with this play button at the top, and then I am going to print a list with print a list. This should print item 1, item 2 and item 3, and it does. Problem 2. Change the second element in B list defined below to 1. B list right now is 0, 0 and 0. And after initializing this list to 0, 0 and 0, we want to change the second element in this list to 1. To do that, with B list square brackets 1 equals 1. And we need to use the index 1 instead of 2 here because Python list is their index. We load the cell with the play button at the top again. And then we are going to print B list. This should print 0, 1 and 0. And it does. Problem 3. Iterate over each element in C list and print it using the 4 elements in syntax. For this one, I am going to write 4 element in C list to iterate over each element in C list and print it using print element. And this should print each element in this list, item 0, item 1 and item 2. And it did. Problem 4. Iterate over each element in D list and print it using the 4 I in range syntax. So instead of using the 4 element in syntax, we are going to write for I in range of 3. In this way, I will go from 0 to 1 to 2. But here, instead of writing 3, we should really write length of D list to make it more general. And remember that length of D list gives us the length of D list, which is 3 in this particular case. And we are going to print each element with print D list square brackets I. Now before I run this, just a quick reminder. In Python, in a for loop block, you need to have 4 spaces inside the block so that Python knows that it's part of the block. And this should print item 0, item 1 and item 2. So let's see. Problem 5. Find the sum of ELIST which contains 32, 55, 710 and 1. We have a new variable called total here. And we are going to use this variable to store the sum of ELIST. And then we will print it at the end of this cell. One thing you could do is you could just write total equals sum of ELIST. And this would give us the correct answer in this particular example. But sometimes it's good to treat a list more carefully than that. For example, when there are mixed types in the given list. So in this example, let's use a for loop to solve this problem. Here, I'm going to write 4 element in ELIST total plus equals element to add the current element to total. And after the for loop, we will just print total. And this should give us 798. And it does. Now that we have reviewed how lists in Python work, let's take a look at a list problem that you might get in an actual coding interview. Here is sample interview question number 1. Here is sample interview question number 1 with array or a Python list. Here is the problem. You are given an array or a Python list of integers. For example, this one on the screen. And I want you to write a function which takes the given array and finds and returns the second largest number in this array. Let's call this function second largest. So second largest of this array on the screen should return 4 because 5 is the largest number in this array and 4 is the second largest. Now, whenever you get a question in your coding interview, you should always ask clarifying questions to make sure you have all the right assumptions. For this question, you might ask, could this array be empty? The answer is yes. You should return none in that case. None in Python, by the way, is like no in some other languages. And it just means that it's an empty value. Could this array or Python list have only one element inside it? Yes. In that case, second largest should return none as well. What if we had say 2 to 1? Then second largest should return 2. You might say, well, it does not really make sense mathematically, but that's just how we define it here. And that the interviewer is really the one who decides if your answer is correct or not. So you should always ask the interviewer what the correct thing to do would be if you are not sure. Now, pause the video, solve the problem, and make sure to run your code to check if it's correct. You can use any language to solve this problem. And if you like to use Python, feel free to use the file for this problem with Jupyter Notebook. So, how should we solve this problem of finding the second largest in a given array of numbers? When you start solving a coding integer problem, you should first visually show your solution instead of jumping into your code right away. I am going to show you my solution visually right here. The idea of my solution is going to be, I am going to take a look at each number in this array or Python list one by one. As we go, we are going to keep track of the largest number that we have seen so far and the second largest number that we have seen so far. To do this, we are going to use variables called largest and second largest in our function. Let's just initialize them to none at first. When we are looking at this element, the first element, largest, becomes 1. And when we are looking at the second element, the largest number we have seen so far is 3. And the second largest number we have seen so far will be 1. Until we get to the last element, where largest becomes 5 and second largest becomes 4. At that point, we are going to return second largest from our function and we are done. Let's see what my solution might look like in code. You can open this file with some test cases, which should be under notebook. From our function second largest, we are going to find and return the second largest number in a given array, except when the length of the array is 1 or 0. In that case, we will just return none and let's implement our function right here. In this function, we will first initialize two variables, largest and second largest. We are going to use these two variables to keep track of the largest number we have seen so far and the second largest number we have seen so far as we iterate through each element in the given list. Let's just initialize them to none. And then we are going to iterate over each element in this list with a for loop. So for that, I am going to write for current number in given list in a for loop. If largest is still equal to none, that would mean that current number that we are looking at currently is the first number in this given list. So we are going to set largest to current number. And if largest is not equal to none, and if current number is larger than largest, then current number will be the new largest number. So we will set largest to current number. But before doing that, we will first set second largest to largest so that we don't lose the value of largest. After these two blocks, we will move on to the second largest number. If second largest number is none at this point, then that would mean that we are looking at the second number in the given list. So in this case, current number in given list is the second number in the given list. So then we will set second largest number to the current number. At this point, we will already know that current number is not the largest number we have seen so far. And if second largest number is not equal to none, and if current number is larger than second largest, then we will set second largest to current number as well. After this for loop, we will just return second largest and we are done. We will load this function with the play button at the top and we will test it with these test cases. The second largest number in 1, 3, 4, 5, 0, 2 should be 4. So our function should return 4 here. And it does. The second largest number in negative 2, negative 1 should be negative 2. So we should return negative 2 here and we do. The second largest number in this list with 2, 2, 1 should be 2. And that's just how we define it. And so we should return 2 here and we do. The second largest number in 2 should be none, and since there is no second largest number here, the second largest number in this empty list should be none, since that's what we want to do for an empty list case. Oh, now that we have covered Python list, let's look into string in the next video.